attention, salute, pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood uniting all mankind
in service and in love.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your goodness to us. God, that we could gather here this morning to worship you. God, I pray that as we move through this service, God, that the teaching of your word would encourage and equip us. God, that you would be honored and glorified in this place. God, we pray for the things that are coming up in the life of the church. We pray especially for VBS as it begins tomorrow, that the children of our church and in this community would clearly hear the gospel and respond to it in faith. God, we long for you to do a tremendous work in this place and through the ministry of this church. We'll be glorified and honored in this place this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning and welcome to First Baptist. We're glad that you are here this morning. Really just two things. Want to go over this morning. One is VBS starting tomorrow. If you have registered to help, but you are unsure of what time you're supposed to be here or when you're supposed to be here, you can see Susan Veazey at the conclusion of the service, and she'll make sure that you have the information that you need. If you are helping but have not yet turned in whatever paperwork you need to help in the children's ministry, I've emailed those of you who have things that are that need to be turned in. Please make sure that you do that so that we have that on record. And in church, just as a whole, pray for this week. Pray. I know that there's been a huge emphasis leading into this week. But we have a tremendous opportunity to speak truth into children this week who are being bombarded with all kinds of messaging and all kinds of worldview. We have an opportunity to give them truth. And our prayer is that they would respond to the gospel, that they would understand their sin and their need for a Savior. And so pray for that this week. One thing that I want to highlight this morning is that we are collecting school supplies in partnership with Bridge Health. It's going to foster children in our area. So in the back, there is a container that you can bring those supplies over the next couple of weeks. That'll end, I believe, sometime in mid-July. I'm waiting to hear when they want us to give that to them. So there's a list that's been published via email. If you've not gotten that email, let me know. But there is a list of supplies that you can bring, and that will go towards a good cause and just an opportunity for us to be a blessing in our community. We're going to continue our time of worship now with our monthly memory verse. This is going to be on the screen. I would encourage you to read this with me. This is Psalm 86:5. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you. Let's continue to worship.
You're What made the pit? Father, pray that you would help us every day to think about our country, to live as you would have us to live for this country. Father, pray that you would bless those in leadership. We pray that you would give them insight, give them strength and courage to lead. Father, we bring this offering. We pray that you'd bless it to your kingdom. Bless those that give. For in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Shout to the Lord, all ye lands. Hey, this little lady behind me, her name is Lindsay Reese Floyd. She is the granddaughter of Wayne and Don Crystal. And this little lady right here, the one in one, that's Miss Becky. I had her when she was like that, okay? And that's how about far back we go, right-o? Yeah. Let me tell you a little bit about Lindsay Reese. She is an upcoming junior, be a junior this fall, at the Northgate High School in Noonan, Georgia. So she's come from Noonan to sing for us today. Her home church down there in Noonan, Georgia, is First Baptist Church of Noonan, Georgia. Lindsay Reese, we are so glad. And, oh, by the way, she's she's part of a bunch of all-star choirs down in that area. State of Georgia, the whole bit. So God has blessed her in a very special way. Were you part of all-star choirs? I didn't think you were. So she's way outdone you. Yeah. Thank you for sharing with us today, okay? It's always good to have you back home. Welcome. We're glad to have you. Yeah, we love you. And love you folks as well. Yeah.
Don't know how it is you looked at me and saw the person that I could be, awakening my heart, breaking through the dark. Suddenly your grace, like sunlight burning life, something so beautiful, beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You are so beautiful, beautiful. Now there's a joy inside I can't contain, but even perfect days can end in rain. And though it's gone down, I see it through the clouds shining on my face, like sunlight burning in midnight, making my life something so beautiful, beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You are so beautiful, beautiful. I cannot undone, but I have just begun, changing by your grace. So beautiful, beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You're so beautiful. Sunlight burning in midnight, making my life something so beautiful, beautiful. Mercy reaching to save me, all that I need. You are so beautiful, beautiful.
That was beautiful, beautiful. That was very, very good. You have a talented voice. Thank you for coming and being willing to share that with us. I'm not hearing myself. Can you all hear me? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Am I alive? Hello, hello, hello. La, la, la. No idea? Am I? Can you all hear me now? Yeah? Oh, okay. Well, good. Here we are, back in the book of Matthew. Find your way over to Matthew chapter 19. We'll be going through the first part of Matthew chapter 19 this morning. This morning, the sermon title is Hard Conversations. Have you ever had to have a hard conversation? Guess not, just me, huh? Hard conversations are never fun to have, but oftentimes they are absolutely necessary. We're continuing through the book of Matthew, and over the past several weeks, we've had some discussions concerning, you know, topics that are difficult, like rebuking sin, forgiving our brothers and sisters in Christ over and over and over again. However, this morning we arrive at one of the most difficult passages in Scripture to discuss and to walk through. However, one of the things that we believe here at First Baptist Church, and I believe wholeheartedly as the pastor here at First Baptist Church, is that we should approach the Word of God expositionally. That means we go verse by verse, word by word, through the entire book of a Bible, and so that way we understand the context. This does a couple different things. One, it requires us to understand the context of what's taking place throughout all of Scripture. Two, it doesn't allow us to skip over passages that make us uncomfortable or that might be difficult. Honestly, if we were to take everything out of this book that's a little bit uncomfortable, difficult, it would probably be only about 7 pages. Wouldn't be much to it. So this morning, we get to a topic that's a little bit heavy and a little bit difficult to discuss, but nevertheless, we're going to discuss it. We're going to be talking about divorce. And divorce is not something that is necessarily easy to talk about, but it is a reality of something that is discussed in God's Word. The truth of the matter is, from the very outset of time, people have struggled in marriage. For us, we've probably all had some level of impact from divorce, whether it was, you know, our parents. Some of you have been divorced yourselves. Some of you have walked through those difficulties. But let me tell you this first and foremost. As we approach the Word of God, God is not in the business of destroying, he's in the business of restoring. God is not in the business of destroying, he's in the business of restoring. So no matter where you are in whatever season of life that you are in, if you had parents who are divorced, if you've walked through divorce yourself, whatever the difficulty of it is, God is not in the business of destroying, he's in the business of restoring. So this morning is not scripture being weaponized to you be used against anyone. It is the truth that sometimes we walk through difficulties in life and sin has an effect on lives, and the reality is sometimes it results in divorce. If you don't know, statistically, on average, over 50% of people get divorced. And the same thing applies within the church. And it's complicated, but Jesus speaks about it. Jesus has to deal with it. Jesus, here in Matthew chapter 19, he's been predicting all along the way that he has to go to Jerusalem, where he will suffer at the hands of the Pharisees and the religious leadership of the time. And so in verse 1, it says, when Jesus had finished saying these things, he departed from Galilee, and he went to the region of Judea across the Jordan. Large crowds followed him, and he healed them there. I find these first couple of verses interesting. It's geographically where Jesus is and what he's in the business of doing. And if we paid attention throughout the book of Matthew, everywhere Jesus goes, people follow after him. Everywhere Jesus goes, there's something about that name. And people are paying attention to the name of Jesus, and they want to follow after him. And so these crowds are gathering with him. And one of the I love this verse because it's crazy how over of a simplification it is. He's traveling from one place to another, and it just simply says, he healed them there. Doesn't that sound like an oversimplification of something that is unbelievably miraculous? Look, Jesus is doing amazing things all along the way, and it says people are following it, and crowds are joining in, and he healed them there. Talk about an oversimplification of something that's just wonderful and splendid. But this is the truth. Our Heavenly Father has sent his Son in such an unbelievable way that, you know, it is simple for him to just heal them there. And what this reminded me of as I approach this passage is this. God is not just in the business of healing physical things. God's also in the business of healing emotional wounds, psychological wounds, mental difficulties. And that's what I think is happening in this passage. Is right before he goes into a difficult conversation concerning marriage and divorce, he says he healed them there. Our God is in the business of bringing about restoration and healing, not about in business of bringing about destruction. And so, they have this encounter, and it says he healed them there, just right there from the outset. However, what we find is there is another group of people that are following after Jesus. It was a group called the Pharisees. The Pharisees are there. Now, I'm here to tell you, church, one of the things that we ought to know is this. There will always be critical people coming alongside to criticize, to test, and destroy, and cause problems in your life. One of the most difficult things, I'll even tell you, as being a pastor, is when you have a church that is our size, you have a whole bunch of opinions, and sometimes a lot of them can be critical. And our tendency in the flesh is to be critical of one another and critical of others in such a way that we're far more willing to say 17 negative things than we are to give one word of encouragement. So let me tell you this morning, when critical people surround you and come to test your life, respond like Jesus does and understand that sometimes criticism comes from opinionated people who just need to keep their mouth shut. But Jesus, dealing with these Pharisees, he knows exactly how to deal with them. They're trying to trap him, and what we'll discover from this passage is a few different truths that are important for us, and the first of which is Jesus is going to give perspective on marriage. Pharisees come to him with a question. It's a trick. It's a trap. Says in verse 3, some Pharisees approached him to test him. Interestingly enough, even from the outset, Jesus knew exactly why they were coming. They were coming to test him. And they said, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife on any grounds? Now, Jesus doesn't just give them a yes or no answer. Jesus actually gives some parameters and understanding. So he responds to them out of his wisdom in verse 4. Haven't you read, he replied, that he who created them in the beginning made them male and female. And he also said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they're no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. I think about even the old school version, let no man put asunder. What a great word that is. This particular passage shows up at a lot of weddings. Jesus, He goes back to the very outset. He goes back to Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2. He says, let's go back to the very outset, the very beginning, and see why God instituted this in the first place. He says, God created marriage. You know that? God created marriage, not man. God instituted marriage. One man, one woman getting married. This is what God has created. What God has joined together, let no one separate. Now, these Pharisees thought they were tricky. They thought they were pulling a fast one on Jesus because they thought they were smarter than Jesus. And so what they do is they establish a question they know they can come and ask Jesus that will cause him to alienate or aggravate one group of people. See, there were two different schools of thought in the religious community at this time. Kind of like you do realize there's a massive cultural divide in our country right now, right? Yeah, especially from a political aspect of looking at things. I mean, if you're going to, you know, say something towards you know, any kind of politics, you're going to tick off one group of people, right? Whether you're you know, a staunch Democrat or a staunch Republican, you say certain things one way or the other, and you're going to completely ostracize an entire group of people because there is a greater level of hostility than I've ever seen in my entire life that is taking place right now. Well, this is what they were trying to set Jesus up to do. To alienate a group of people, because one group of religious thinkers, they thought at this time that the only reason why you could get divorced was if there was an immoral or sinful action. The other group thought you could get divorced for any reason. Now we're going to have to unpack why they would have thought this, and we'll get there in just a few minutes, but they tried to set him up so that Jesus would have to aggravate a particular group of people. But Jesus, guess what? He's smarter than they are. He's not intimidated, he's not ostracized, no. He puts the conversation right where the conversation needs to be. He puts it on God's original design from God's word. He doesn't worry about who he's going to impress or not impress. The reality is divorce was not God's original plan. And we have to recognize that God's design and God's plan is what is best. Now, honestly, every single person in this room, myself included, is a sinner. Every one of us. Every one of us have fallen short of the glory of God and deserve his wrath. But instead, we get the grace and mercy of a glorious God. So it does not matter where you have fallen or if it's this sin or another sin. What we do is not come with a critical spirit, but no, we come with truth, wanting restoration, not destruction. And so while it's not God's original plan, it does take place. But sin was not God's original design, and so we must carefully say that in divorce, it was not God's original plan. Now, I clarify, when I say divorce is a result of sin, it's not necessarily both people's sin, but often it takes two to tango. And the truth of the matter is, something happened along the way, because nobody walks down the aisle and says, I hope we have a good 7 years and divorce you after that. Nobody plans on getting divorced, but it takes place and it happens, right? With me? Understand, difficult material, we just got to be real with it, just got to walk through it and talk through it. And so Jesus gives this perspective on marriage, and he precisely goes back to creation. Genesis 1 and 2, God created marriage for this design to bring glory to him and give an example of who he is. Secondarily, we're going to see perspective on divorce. Pharisees, not satisfied, they want to dig deeper, they're still trying to trap Jesus. And so they don't shy away, and so Jesus begins to drop some more truth on them. Because they come to him prying with a deeper question. They say, why then, they asked him, did Moses command us to give divorce papers to send her away? He told them, Moses permitted you to divorce your wives because of the hardness of your hearts. But it was not like that from the beginning. I tell you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. Now, here's where it gets tricky. These Pharisees, they're smart folks. They knew the Torah. They knew the Word of God. They knew the first five books. They knew the Law and the Prophets. And they come to Jesus quoting Scripture. They're like, what about Deuteronomy 24, chapter verse 1? You know, if a man marries a woman and she becomes displeasing to him because he finds something indecent about her, he may write her a divorce certificate, hand it to her, and send her away from his house. So if your wife's getting on your nerves, you can divorce her. Well, let me just tell you this. If you've been married for any length of time, your spouse is going to get on your nerves. You know what? You can love your spouse as much as you want to, but at some point, they're annoying. Should have at least gotten one amen, but... Probably didn't want to get in trouble, I know. Look, the truth is, Jesus points out, or these Pharisees point out to Jesus, well, what about this? Moses wrote this. This is in Deuteronomy. This is Scripture. It says this. It says, you can give her papers if she's getting on your nerves and send her out of your house. And Jesus says, look, that was permitted because of the hardness of your hearts. because of your sinfulness against God, because you wanted to rebel against God's design, it was permitted. Just because something is permissible doesn't mean it's good. I can eat 17 pieces of cheesecake, but it's probably not a good idea. Just because something's permissible doesn't mean that it's good for you. And so Jesus is saying, because of people's rejection of God's law was so great and out of control, essentially Moses permitted this because of people's sinful chaos. Now he's going to establish some rules around this, but Jesus appeals back further than Moses. He goes back to creation. He talks about marriage is God-ordained and it's not supposed to be broken. However, he gives some exemptions, some clarifications for this. Says sexual immorality gives an allowance for divorce because that level of betrayal is so detrimental and hurtful to the heart. It's destructive and it's difficult. And so if one spouse is unfaithful, then there is an allowance for divorce because these people are in a covenant before God. However, Jesus does not say that the spouse who is offended is required to get a divorce, because again, God is all about restoration, not destruction. And that's not doesn't mean that it's easy. Does not forgiveness of sin is not easy. There was this guy, he went to a cross and was brutally put to death because of sin. So dealing with sin is not easy. So he says there's another allowance, though. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7, the Apostle Paul, in speaking to the church in Corinth, he gives one other exemption that shows up in Scripture, and that is the exemption of abandonment. Meaning that if you are in Christ and your spouse is not, and they decide to leave you, then you can allow them to leave. So marriage is a covenant between us and our spouse, and it is a covenant in the eyes of God. That's why weddings are done in churches. They're done in the presence of witnesses, and they're a covenant agreement. So Jesus had an unbelievable standard for marriage, right? We read the Bible, and it's like, that's high-level stuff. And so the disciples, realizing how big of a deal this is, they come up with a question that's like, what about single people? They're like, wouldn't it just be easier to not get married and just stay single? It seems like a great idea. What a plan. And so his disciples came to him. This is verse 10. He said, if the relationship of a man with his wife is like this, it's better not to get married. Essentially, he's saying, man, that's too tough. I don't know how to do that. So here we go. Jesus deals with this in verse 11. He responded, not everyone can accept this saying. Woo, he's setting you up right there. Not everyone can handle this. Not everyone can accept this saying, but only those to whom it's been given. For there are eunuchs who are born that way from their mother's womb. There are eunuchs who are made by men, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves that way because of the kingdom of heaven. The one who is able to accept it should accept it. Now Jesus is referring to, you know, those who can handle it. And we have to look and see what he means, because he starts having conversation about eunuchs. And some of you are like, what on earth is a eunuch? I've never heard that in my life. All right, so we're not going to get into a great deal of explicit detail about eunuchs. I will tell you this, they have a physical incapability of being able to function in the sexual part of a union between husband and wife. And if you need more detail, come see me after worship and I'll explain. Okay? So they're eunuchs for a variety of reasons. Some have chosen a life of singleness. Look, there is a truth that exists. There are some that have chosen to walk in a life of singleness. There are some who have not chosen to be single and yet have remained single. I know plenty of young men and young women who thought they were going to be married in their young 20s, and they start getting up in age and they worry about being married, and that's just sometimes the reality of life. Jesus says some that can walk in that will walk in that. And then he goes on to say, though, you were designed to be married. Some of you, it can handle being single and walk through life that way. Some of you cannot. And he's saying God has designed things for marriage. And Jesus said, look, if you're able to accept a life of singleness, then you can. However, if not, then you need to seek a holy marriage relationship. All right, church, now we're going to have a bit of a commercial session, all right? So what this is a little historical explanation for us. There was something that took place in culture that totally shifted the dynamic and the understanding of getting married. You know, in the United States now, we're actually pushing the age of marriage later and later and later in life, right? We've seen this being taking place. And it's fascinating to me, because you travel back a little more than 100 years ago, and the average age of people getting married was 16, 17 years old. But what on earth took place? Well, it was in the mid-1800s what took place. Mid-1800s, there was a gigantic shift in the United States of America. We shift from being primarily driven as an agricultural society to an industrialized society. The industrialization of the United States created a new category of existence. Follow with me on this, all right? Before the industrialization of the United States, yes, there was the term teenager, because somebody would be 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. However, adolescence wasn't actually created until the mid of the 1800s in the United States. And it happened during the industrialized movement. Because what took place was, typically, people grew up in communities on farms with family. You get about 16, 17 years old. You marry a young woman. And by the time you read their obituary, they were married for 70 years, grew up raising families on farms. But when the industrialized movement took place, there was a moving from the outskirts to the city. And when people moved to the city, they were congregating in these areas. Instead of having these younger 13, 14, and 15-year-olds work in factories, there was this new creation of a teenage culture. This was when the advent of the YMCA took place. I'm not sure if you knew historically that it's that old, but that's when it took place. And you had this congregation now of those who are around that age, and the dynamic of the age at which marriage was began to be pushed further and further and further and further. And what we had was the removing of responsibility, which created a chasm that allowed to creep in a lack of desire for responsibility. Now, I don't have chapter and verse in the Bible for this. I don't think that's God's design. And I'm not saying that we should have 16-year-olds getting married, but because the reason why I'll explain that is because of our culture has created a juvenilization of the understanding and maturity of our young people. Our young people have such a greater capability than we hold them to responsibility-wise that we have created a culture that has allowed this to exist. I don't think that was God's original design, because the truth of the matter is, I know that there are some young people in here, so I'll keep this, you know, at a PG level. But I don't think that God created us sexually to have the desire and then tell us to wait 15 years to be able to use that desire. I don't think that God, in all of his wisdom, would have designed us that way. So, what I'm saying is he gives us this perspective on understanding, and he helps us to understand that whether you are married or whether you are single, you're supposed to be seeking out a holy life. So if God's calling you to singleness, embrace that and live with it and learn to do ministry the best way that you can. Because I'll tell you, a lot of times single people don't like being single. And sometimes they do. It just depends. If God has called you to marriage, you pursue and develop a holy marriage and sustain that. Now, in this passage, it's interesting that there's also an extra connection that Jesus gives that maybe doesn't seem like it fits, but it does. If you'll jump down to verse 13, Jesus gives us some perspective on children. It was common in Jesus' day for Jewish people, especially rabbis, to have children come around them, lay hands on them, bless them, pray with them, speak words of truth over them. And so parents would bring Jesus these children for the very purpose. And in verse 13, it says, then the children were brought to Jesus for him to place his hands on them and pray. But the disciples rebuked them. Jesus said, leave the children alone and don't try and keep them from coming to me, because the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. After placing his hands on them, he went on from there. Wow. Children were often not thought of very highly in that culture. And, I'll be honest with you, okay? If you hang out with Piper for a couple hours, after question number 1,742, you're probably going to be wanting to send her away too. The disciples try and rebuke the kids, and Jesus is like, nah. Jesus rebukes the disciples. It's like, he says, they're such as the kingdom of heaven. Bring the kids, man. Let them be around you. Let them love and learn and be blessed and pray and be engaged with. Shameless plug, next week's Vacation Bible School. Love children. Be here just to love on them. Hand out snacks. Sweep a floor. Doesn't matter what you do, just be loving on children. Such is the kingdom of heaven. You want to understand the kingdom of heaven? Kids. He said, Jesus says saying that. Scripture's saying that, not me. So, look, he calls them to live like this, and so he blesses them. The disciples probably thought now Jesus is too important for the kids. You know, send the kids away. You know, he doesn't need to have the kids. Jesus is like, no, bring them here. I'm their creator. I've got time for each and every one of them. So God has a love for married people, single people, divorced people, children. He has a design and a plan for all of it. God has designed and has a love for us, and so we should not seek to step outside of God's plan, but to the best of our ability to walk in God's plan. So how do we deal with this? Well, it's a hard conversation, because some of us have walked through it and faced it, and it's very difficult. The truth of the matter is, if there's sin going on, we ought to be pointing sin out, but we do so with unbelievable love and graciousness. We don't come as Pharisees. No, we come as Jesus did, with grace and mercy. Divorce is painful and ugly, and those who are walking through it, my goodness, they need love. And it's always complicated. You know, sometimes people go through divorce and they don't want to. They're trying to stay, and they don't have a choice. Sometimes things just got too far, and sin went too far, and fights went too far, and there is no restoration. But we should seek to love them. Look, I told the two early services this, and I'll tell you the exact same thing. One of the things I love about First Baptist Church is that we have three worship services. One of the things that I hate about First Baptist Church is that we have three worship services. I have no problem with contemporary music, and I have no problem with hymns. I have no problem preaching three times in a row. Sometimes my voice doesn't like that, but I have no problem doing that. It doesn't faze me at all. But what I think we have eliminated is something that it was very beneficial for the church, and it's called intergenerational contact. Some of you in this room have been married 50 years. Some people have been, services have been married 5 months. How much could you influence with your 50 years into their 5 months? Because I told them this morning. Some of you have been married, 25, 30, 40 years, whatever it may be, this lengthy period of time. If they were to come to you, I know exactly what you'd say. It's been all sunshine and rainbows. It's been easy the whole time. The answer to that is absolutely not. Because you're human just like I am, and sometimes your spouse gets on your nerves. But you listen to truth, and you don't go to bed mad, and you have hard conversations, and you fight to keep it. So we need this intergenerational contact. So how do we do this? Well, we seek to be loving and holy in all of our relationships. I heard something a long, long time ago that has stuck with me that I think is very beneficial. It's this. Sometimes it makes people uncomfortable, but I've discovered it to be more and more true along the way. God is more interested in making you holy than he is in making you happy. God is more interested in making you holy than he is in making you happy. But when you walk in holiness, you will find happiness. It's a weird thing, but it's the way that it works. So if you're single, be loving and holy. If you're divorced, be loving and holy. If you're married, be loving and holy. If you're remarried, be loving and holy. If you're widowed, be loving and holy. If you're in a different marriage, be loving and holy. Whatever the case it is, we are called to restoration, not destruction. Praise be to God that we have mercy for the sin that is in our life, because he went to the cross for us. So we seek to find forgiveness. Now, I'm going to make a very clear instruction known this morning. Yes, we are called to love and forgive and to walk to the best of our ability in restoration. However, if you are in an abusive relationship, you seek help. God is not saying you need to stay where you're being abused. Now, I want to also clarify even that statement itself. We live in a culture where now we can say, everything's abuse. Somebody did something very small and it's not. No, but I'm saying there are very real and very difficult situations where there's genuine wrong and sinful abuse that is taking place. God is not calling you to stay to that. Am I clear on that? I want to make sure that that's very well understood. So get help. Find somebody you trust and love. Come to somebody at the church. To the best of our means necessary, we are to seek restoration. We're to call one another to holiness. We're supposed to live to seek in love and walking in our own holiness. Because people oftentimes are hurting. And we need to come to them lovingly, supporting them, challenging them to walk in holiness. Establish good relationships, healthy walks with people in your life. Examine yourself this week. At the end of every service, I think it's very significant and important for us to look in our own hearts and ask ourselves, well, what now? What do I do with all of this now that's been written upon my heart? But we seek to walk in the best relationships we can. So if you're married, be a loving and holy spouse. If you're single, live to be the best holy person that you can be. If you're a parent, love your children. Give them that example. Be loving and holy as God has called us to be. Now, I know that this is not, believe me, I've not been super excited about preaching this sermon all week, because difficult subjects are not fun. And, people walking in seasons of life, man, it's hard. But God has designed a way for us to live. Let's seek out his design that we can walk in it and become more holy. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word, even the places where it's difficult for us to be obedient. Even the places where it's hard and we don't want to be obedient. God, this morning as we've walked through a difficult section of your word, my prayer is that your spirit come alongside us and ride upon our heart an understanding of how we are to be loving and holy. God, that even in the midst of our weakness, God, that you are helping us to grow. God, we ask you to do a work in us in these last moments. In Jesus' name we pray.
Let's stand together, please.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. I still will follow. Though none go with me,
I still will follow.
Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before.
Would be seated for just a moment. First I want to say, you know, thank you to our choir for working on some extra music this morning. We appreciate that greatly. Lindsay, thank you for being an out-of-town guest. And you have a wonderful voice, so keep doing that. It was good to have you here. Hopefully we can have you back another time again. One bit of church business that we need to address this morning that you may or may not be aware of. Over the past few weeks, Chris Bruce, who for the past 7 years has led our two contemporary worship services, has taken a step back for a period of time. And just certain seasons of life where people are walking through, you know, different moments that can sometimes be complicated, cause them to have to take a different season of life to do something else. And so while he's served faithfully for 7 years, Chris's time has come to a conclusion with serving in that capacity. That doesn't mean he won't be around, and it does not mean that we are supposed to not love on him and encourage him and reach out to him and thank him for his many years of service here at the church. But we'll be having a transition in that position in our first two services, and so we'll be looking to have somebody fill that position. In the meantime, I said a special thank you in both services, and I'll say it in this one as well, to Krista Savage, who's kind of been filling that spot, playing the piano and singing, leading herself. And so she's a wife and a mama, and she's got a job, and so that's just an extra thing on her plate. But just want to publicly say thank you for her, you know, filling that particular space. And then the other thing that even though I was reminded multiple times by Debbie Gossett to do, I completely forgot until just right this moment about something that I was supposed to have done that I haven't done. And I know you guys think I'm a genius, but I don't remember stuff very easily. So here's what I forgot. Hey, Chris Harper, come here. Chris Harper is our youth pastor, and the reality is this morning I have a card to give you. Now, it's in my box over my office, so I don't actually have it here. But Debbie reminded me, but I forgot this entire week. So Chris has been serving here for 1 year as our youth pastor. He's doing an incredible job. Just got back with kids from camp. Kids love him. He's been encouraging and doing a phenomenal job. And so I want to publicly say thank you, Chris. We appreciate your ministry. And you made it 1 year, buddy.
1 year.
1 year. 1 year down.
Thank you,
Chris.
Thank you all.
All right, Brother Genie, send us home.
All right, thank you for being here with us at First Baptist Church today for our freedom celebration. We close today with America the Beautiful. Stand together as we close our service out. Thank you again for being with us. Lindsey Reese, come back anytime, okay?
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies forever, waves of green, for purple mountain majesty, above the fruited plain. America, America, shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood, from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for pilgrim feet, whose sturdy passion stressed, author of fair for freedom beat across the
bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon. Singers, thank you so much.